gluten-free diets and products are everywhere these days. As of 2014, an estimated 3 million people in the US alone had sworn off gluten.
So what we don't know from those numbers is how many of those people were avoiding gluten because they heard that the gluten-free diet is healthy, or they heard that gluten is just bad for everyone, which it's not, versus people who are actually experiencing some kind of symptom and attributing that to gluten.
Some people blame gluten for symptoms like abdominal pain, bloating, and fatigue, but don't have celiac disease. The autoimmune reaction to this villainized complex of proteins found in wheat, barley, and rye.
And those are the cases that some doctors and researchers are really puzzling over and sort of trying to get to the bottom of.
Here's what we know. Certain researchers are convinced that some people have an immune reaction to gluten or to some other substance in wheat. A study published in 2016 tested blood samples from 80 patients who had symptoms after eating wheat. It found that these patients had higher levels of a class of antibodies against a component of gluten. The team also found elevated levels of two proteins that indicate an inflammatory response to bacteria. This doesn't necessarily mean gluten itself was causing illness, but the researchers propose that some part of wheat prompts the intestinal lining to become more permeable. Then the wheat components and gut bacteria sneak past immune cells in the intestinal tissue, make their way to the bloodstream and liver, and cause inflammation. But another camp thinks most patients don't have an immune reaction to wheat. Instead, they believe that most are really reacting to an excess of FODMAPs.
Fermentable oligo, dimonosaccharides, and polyols. So it's this category of carbohydrates that are not easily absorbed by the intestines. And so they can ferment in the gut, and that can cause gas and bloating.
FODMAPs are widespread in our diets. Carbohydrates in wheat, called fructans, could account for as much as half of a person's FODMAP intake. Some researchers believe that many people feel better after eliminating wheat from their diet, not because of an immune reaction to gluten or other wheat components, but because they're reducing their FODMAPs. Proponents of a low FODMAP diet say it's less restrictive than going totally gluten-free, because people can reintroduce FODMAPs to find a threshold that keeps their symptoms in check.
So this group based at the University of Oslo in Norway designed this study to sort of try to tease out the effects of FODMAPs versus gluten. And what they did was they recruited people who were already on a gluten-free diet, and they had them try one of three different indistinguishable snack bars that had either pure gluten or a FODMAP called fructan, or neither, a placebo bar. And they would eat one of the bars for a week, report their abdominal symptoms, and then switch until they had tried all three of the bars without knowing which was which. In the end, FODMAPs caused the worst symptoms by a small margin. And also, more than a third of the people in the study reported their worst symptoms after the placebo bar.
What a mess.
It was a mess. So the researchers concluded that in most cases, FODMAPs were the culprit, sort of generally in the population. People were reacting to FODMAPs, not something specifically in wheat. But there's been skepticism about that study. People who say that, well, you didn't really recruit the people who were likely to have an immune reaction to wheat and not to FODMAPs. So the case is not closed.
Rather than one single cause or culprit, the illnesses attributed to gluten may actually be due to multiple nuanced conditions. So how will this affect our choices at the grocery store and at the dinner table? Well, don't do anything too drastic yet. Experts say if you suspect you're reacting to wheat, see a doctor and rule out celiac disease before going gluten-free. A dietitian can also help manage symptoms without cutting out so many foods that you're missing out on important nutrients.
Because there aren't a lot of good answers about the possible causes of these conditions, a lot of people, when they go to the doctor or to a dietitian, are still being encouraged to just experiment, try cutting out gluten and see if it works for them. So that's sort of where we are right now. I think a lot of people are just sort of figuring out what makes them feel best.